Hi. I built a new lab. That's what took me so long. But now I'm back. And there's more to come on the 8-bit computer. Right now.
I'm gonna show you around a little. This is the workbench I made. And the place where I do most of my work now. This is the soldering station. And this is the place where I read and learn and think. And stuff. So yeah. I have plenty space left there because I'm gonna gear up, probably. I need more test equipment. And this is where parts and books and tools are. My soldering fume hood. Let me turn it on. So what it does, the most important part is that it blows away sort of fumes and it sucks it in to the top. That works really, really well. And this is my soldering iron there, and some flux and solder, everything you need, basically. And over there, you have the 8-bit computer, keyboard, and a breadboard with. Yeah, I've been playing around with the GPIO pins and a heart shaped LED thing. Yeah, this is my scope. It has an annoyingly loud fan, some monitors, computer, and yeah, plenty space left for more test gear. And this is my really, really old but still working and super cool looking power supply. Oh, excuse the poor camera work, but yeah, this is a power supply and it does actually do the job. You can dial up your voltage here and it's current limited and everything. And here's a USB hub and a clock. So it's, yeah, it's 033, that's 12:30 a.m. and at night. Yeah, and it's quite dark in here at night because I don't have, in fact, any lights installed yet. If you look up there, there's just nothing, but yeah, that's gonna be changed soon, I hope. This is my temporary light that I got here now. And of course, a professional hot glue gun. Yeah, it's professional, it must be good. More USB hub. Yeah. But enough of the boring stuff. Let's go on with some 8-bit magic.
Yeah, and I'm also gonna do this with a little bit less perfection from now on because I want to get more content done in less time, and it's gonna be more off the cuff. Like, I'm just gonna talk and I'm gonna make mistakes, and I'm tired of using a lot of time to say the same sentence 4 or 5 times, or writing down a script or doing that. Which is funny because this is actually the second time I'm trying to tell this, but I totally screwed up the first time. But no more takes now. I'm gonna turn on the computer, and this will be the first part of a series I'm gonna make that's called Bare Metal Computing. And what it does is, or what I'm going to do is, I'm going to show you how programming basically works from the low level. So I'm going to start with simple CPU instructions and basically do a lot of interesting stuff. This is about as low as you can get from a software perspective. And there are videos on YouTube by a guy, I think his name is Mad Max or something like that. I will put a link in the description. And he starts computing from the transistor level. So if you want to go even deeper, watch his videos. And I'm gonna start where he is headed to. He wants to build a computer with a working CPU, and that's it. And I'm gonna use a just barely working computer with a CPU and a machine code monitor and build up all the other levels of that. And I have lots of ideas what we can do with that. But I'm not sure about the path I'm going to take, because it will change. I will discover new things, and that's what makes it fun. So, let's get started.
So this is the prototype. We will ignore the LED heart for now, and let's turn it on. Monitor needs power, and this is the machine code monitor. So I've improved the machine code monitor, and now it's in a state where you can basically see the most important things and use it well to show off some cool things. There are three parts to it. This is the memory listing. You can look through memory, which is mostly empty now, and you can select single addresses and write stuff into it. We will come to that later. And these are the registers. So there are quite a few registers: A, B, C, D, E, H, L, F, and the F register has some fancy stuff going on up here, and there are program count and stack pointer and some index registers and also an alternate register set. There's two or three, I think, more registers which are not so important that are not listed here. And the third part over here is what I call the byte inspector, that lets you view the byte you select up there in different kinds of representations. And that's the most basic thing to understand if you work on a low level. The CPU does not know what the bits you put into memory actually can mean. So everything that actually exists is a representation like that. You have these eight little circles, these are the eight bits, and you can make different patterns out of these eight bits by turning each bit on or off. So you can turn them all on or all off, or half of them on, or in an alternating fashion like that or that. And if we look at maybe this representation here, this is three bits on, then one is off, another on, and three off. This can mean different things. It can mean the number 23, or 17 in hexadecimal, or it can be that weird symbol over there. If we in fact look at this, this can be the number 65, or the letter A, a big capital A, or 41 in hexadecimal. You can also do stuff like that, all bits on. In this character set it's a blue square, number 255, or if we say this is a sign bit and we use a certain representation for negative numbers called the 2's complement, then this would be minus 1. But this is all in our imagination. You can in fact change the character set, you can do another kind of representation for numbers, such as an offset representation, or maybe even binary coded decimal or whatever. It's all in our mind, basically. The CPU only sees this and operates only on bits, and this is what we make up of these. But you can assign different meanings to that. You can, this bit pattern could be, well, designated for a cat or whatever you think about. I don't know. What's important is that when the computer operates on this data, it always does it in the same way. And there are certain ways of representing numbers that are very important and useful, because you can then use the instruction that the computer provides to do, well, useful things like doing an addition instruction, and when you look at the bits and the number representation, it really does do a addition operation on them. But the computer itself does not know if the thing it's working on is actually a number, if it is interpreted as a positive or always positive number, or if it has a sign bit, or if you are adding up cats and apples. It does not know what the bit representations actually mean. Except for one thing. These bit representations can also be part of code. Part of opcodes, actually. These are bit patterns that make up a program. So you see the F5 option there. If I were to hit F5 now, the machine code monitor would tell the CPU to start reading from this address here and interpret this as a program. So it's all filled up with zeros now. 00 is actually a instruction which says do nothing. It's the no operation instruction, which is not very exciting. In fact, it would run through all these pages of memory until it hits possibly the stack or something, and then it does something weird. Let's put a actually useful, well, bit useful bit of code in there, maybe by using this bit pattern here. 3D and hexadecimal, and it is one bit on, one bit off, and so on. Does not really matter. And we put another one here. I will explain these shortly. If I hit F5 now, let's use 3C. That's easier for now. If we hit 5 now, it will interpret this and this as code and actually do something. And what it does, where there was a 0, now there's a 1. If we hit 5 again, there's a 2, 3. It can actually count up. So these are numbers in hexadecimal, of course, so it goes to A, B, C, D, E, F, and then 1, 0. And there are things happening in the F register. We will look at that later. So what is this? This is a code for increase the A register. And this is the code for return. In this case, it will return to where it came from, which is the machine code monitor. If we were to leave that out, it would go on, do nothing until it crashes into some other code that comes later in memory, and then it would probably reset, but I don't want to crash the machine now. So there's another opcode which I typed in first. This does the opposite. It counts down. It also obviously sets this bit here. Yeah, but this counts down. Yeah, and this is what happened when I put this one in first. If we go down to 0, well, it just wraps around and goes down from FF. Yeah, and we can go, this is another one. That's not the one I wanted to use, actually. But we can play around with that. 3 is another one. Say we want to load 5, which is a nice bit pattern, as you can see, into the A register. We can do this with 3E. 3E is the load A register instruction, and it also takes an operand after it. So it loads 5 into the A register, and then this is just the end of our program. So this is how you can tell the CPU what to do. So in a way, it does know what we mean by that, but that's the only representation that the CPU, you can say, knows about. If we have data in here, like if I were to put down my age, I'm not 18, I'm 24, I'm 18 in hexadecimal, yeah, then the CPU would not know that this is my age, but I can write a program that does something useful with it, like calculate the year I was born or something like that. Yeah. Or I could write my name in here, actually. Let me do it like this. So I have my name in here now, STEFAN. But these could be also a bunch of random numbers. Again, the data that's actually stored in memory is only these bit patterns. Also, what's important here is, as you can see, we have code up here, program, and some data in the same memory. This is called the von Neumann architecture. There are CPUs, in fact most microcontrollers like the Atmel AVR and the PIC, I think, they have separate spaces for code and memory, which is fine because that makes them operate much faster, because in one cycle they can fetch one piece of code and the data. But they are made for things like a washing machine control or something that you program once and it does its thing. But you cannot go around with something like this and type in code and experiment with them so much. You always need another system, a PC or something, that you can write the code on and load it onto the machine. I wanted a architecture like this so I can experiment with it without any other hardware. I can just turn it on, plug in a keyboard and a monitor and hack around. That's what makes this system fun. Okay, let's do something more advanced now. I'm gonna hit the reset button to clear everything. Okay, let's go into the memory, and I will maybe at this point here at address E050, you can also read it there. I will write a bunch of numbers, maybe like 84 and yeah, 13. These two numbers. And up here, I want to write a program that adds up these two numbers and puts the sum here. So I don't know every CPU instruction. In fact, these three or four I used earlier, that are the only ones I knew in my head. For everything else, there's this bunch of dead trees where there's a single page for each instruction. Some even span two pages. So the first thing we need is an addition instruction. Here's the summary on the add instruction. And as you can see, there are several kinds of different add instructions. And the difference between them is what kind of memory they access, actually. So you can, like this means you can add the A register and, well, what's listed over here. You can take the A register plus some value in memory, and well, the HL register says where in memory the other operand is, or you can add an index register value, or well, some value in memory but the index register and some offset says where it is. Here you can add a constant immediate value, just like the one we had with the load instruction before. Well, that's just add a fixed number. or add something from another register. And we are probably gonna use this one. Yeah, we want something from memory. And as far as I can see, yeah, these are 16-bit adds. These two are the only two that allow me to add something from memory. Well, we could load it into a register first from memory and then add, but I think going with HL directly would be faster and easier. So the code for that, we don't even have to look up the special page. It's 86. Okay, but we need to fill the HL register first, and we will probably have to set the accumulator, the A register is also called accumulator because most operations store their result in the A register. Oh, that's another thing I forgot to mention. Well, if most of these instructions, well, probably all of them that have a result, put it into the first register mentioned here, and that's for most of them the A register. So this add instruction takes A and something else, adds it, and then the old value of A gets overwritten with the result. That's how it works, and that's why it's called the accumulator, because all the results accumulate in there. So now let's find a way to load our address. Oh, come on, focus. The address. It says, here are the numbers. This address, where the numbers are, into the HL register pair. This is the instruction that we need. We can load a register pair, like H and L, with some values. Well, we could all take the value from memory, but that would be kind of stupid. In this case, at least. So we want to put a known fixed value in there. So this is the variant we need. So these MMNN, just ignore third byte here. That's for a special 24-bit mode that a machine has. We don't use this yet. We use the Z80 mode, where addresses are only 16-bit. So we can load these two fixed bytes into a register pair. But there are different opcodes for that, and that's because there's not only HL, but there's also BC and DE. And we have to look up which one we actually need. So this is the page for load register pair. And so the opcode is just KK, and then there's the value in KK. Well, it depends on the register you want to load into, and in this case we want the HL register, so the opcode is just 21. We use 21, and then there comes the address. And this is a little endian machine. Little endian means the little end of a multi-byte value comes first. So if we want to say, we want to load E050 into there, these are 2 bytes, E0 and 50. The little part, the least significant part, comes first, and then the other one. I won't go into the details of why it is done this way on this machine now. It has certain benefits, I think. It's kind of, some people are very religious on things like that. There's a kind of flame war that's probably going on for centuries, whether little endian or big endian, which one is better, or if it doesn't matter at all, or whatever. When I run this code now, I've put a return here so we don't run into our data here. So then we have our desired value into the H and L registers. That's nice. And what we also need to do is to clear the A register. Well, right now it is cleared, but we could have something in there. AF is the opcode for that. What that actually is an XOR operation, exclusive OR. But it's between the A register and the A register. And XOR is an operation that outputs a 1 when the two bits are different, and a 0 when they're the same. So if you do XOR of one the same register, the result will always be 0, and the result gets stored in the A register. So this is the fastest and easiest way to load 0 into the A register. I could also do things like that, 3E00, but that would be 2 bytes. This is just easier to write. And put it here, please. So we have the HL register pointing here now. That's what a pointer is, basically. And yeah, it's really, that's what pointers are. It's not too scary on the low level. It may be scary if you're fighting with the C compiler, but right now, well, it's just some address stored on a register, and we know that that address is the address of a number we want to add. And that's why we use the next instruction, which I already forgot, but I think it was 89 or something like that, adding to the accumulator the value pointed to by HL, and yeah, 86. So now, well, we can try this. So yeah, now this got added to A, and well, we can now move HL to the next position. We could use the 2150 51E0 now, but there's a much easier way to do this, which is just to increment it. And there's also an instruction for that. Increment a register pair here, or increment something, basically. Increment something. Where is it? Increment a 2-byte something, which could be something in memory, or the index register, or the IX. Oh, the SS. I don't know why. It's not only for 2-byte things. This would increment 1-byte values, but you can also increment a 2-byte value, which is very nice. And we have to look that one up again. It's something among these lines. So increment the HL register. That's what we want to do. Here it is, and the little table says 2-3. Oops, sorry. That's kind of annoying. Why doesn't it focus? Well, okay. 2-3. And for now we will just put this one in here again, and then do C9. Okay, we have a number in A now, which in fact is the sum of these two. But now we want to just for, yeah, because I said it, we also said that we want to store the result here, but I will store the result here because I don't want to add only two numbers. I want to add a whole bunch of numbers. The instruction we need for that, for storing the result in memory, is one of these. Load into a memory location on a fixed address from the A register. Oh, it's already written here. So it's 3-2. The camera was not in focus. And I'm gonna do this part again. So I found out that the opcode is 3-2, and here comes the address where we want to store the result. And C9 for return. Yeah, I've changed the numbers here. So let's try some 1 and 1 now, and 1 up program. And in fact, the result is 2. We can also maybe use some bigger numbers like 21 and 68. And the result is 89. We've been looking at this representation, by the way. But the CPU does not know that we think of these as unsigned 8-bit numbers. We could also be thinking about them as maybe signed numbers. If we in fact put FF in here, this is a minus 1 and this is 21. If we do the addition now, as we can see in this representation, the result also works. That's what's so beautiful about the 2's complement, because it works the same on a bit level, so the CPU does not know about that. And we could also do something like use the letter A, use the letter A and add to it, let's in fact use that here, and put a 1 here, and the result is the letter A, yeah. And if you put a 5 here, then the result is E. The fifth letter in the alphabet is E. Or if you put, let's say, 26 here, well, it's Z. So we can use this to add, well, or to, yeah, to get a letter from the alphabet by its number. If you put 2 in here, that's B, and so on. Yeah, I think you get it. So the same program does different things depending on how we interpret data. That's kind of cool. So I said we want to add more than 2 numbers. Well, I could just repeat that, increment the HL register and add, but that would, well, it would not be very efficient. I had type a lot, and if there were really, really many numbers, the program would get really, really large. But in fact, I can do, well, what's called a loop. Use these 2 instructions and do them several times. So, what we can use for that is, well, a loop. At first, we will need to say how many numbers. Let's say we add the whole row, 16 numbers. And we have to store that somewhere, and a very good location for that is the B register, because it's kind of made for that purpose on this CPU. So loading into the B register is... Okay, from now I'm not gonna show you what the page looks like. Well, it's always that there's a table where I can look these things up. So, I don't know these offhand, I just look them up from now on, and you won't notice, because I edit all the, looking through the pages, I edit that all out. So, the opcode for loading something into the B register is 06. I will copy my program to the second line here, so we have the old version as a reference there. So, before we start adding up anything, well, we have cleared and set our, cleared the A register, and we have set the HL to here. And before we do anything else, we load the B register with the number of times we want to repeat the whole thing. And we say we want to add 16 numbers, so we put a 16 here, 10 in hexadecimal. Load the number of times we want to repeat into the B register, then comes our addition, and we move the HL register value one further. And now we use a very, very nice instruction. I'm gonna show you that one, because it's very, very nice and important on the Z80. So it is the DJNZ instruction. So it decrements B and jumps if it is not 0. So if we have maybe 3 in B, first time it counts down to 2 and jumps, then it counts down to 1 and jumps, and then it counts down to zero and doesn't jump. So we have the first iteration before we hit it the first time, so we have two jumps, so we repeat the whole thing three times if we had three in the B register. So the same thing if we have 16 in the B register, we will run through it and once, twice, and so on, and we will jump 15 times, so this gets executed 16 times. And the opcode for that one is 10, and now there is a offset that we have to specify because, well, it doesn't know where to jump, what to repeat. And we want to repeat only that, so we have to jump here. And we need to say how many bytes the program counter has to go back. And that's counted from after the jump instruction. The jump instruction is these two bytes, 10 and the offset, and we have to count from here. So we go back 1, 2, 3, 4. We have to say -4. And that's what the byte inspector is really, really good for. So we say from, oh, I have to put that here. So it reads that basically, and then the program counter is here, but instead of going on from here where it would continue, we go back by 1, 2, 3, 4, and it does this again, and 1, 2, 3, 4, and it jumps until B is counted down to 0, and then we still have to put our result down. Something is wrong. Oh, this is wrong. This is the part where we add, and here we add it again, and then this is where we output. I guess there were people screaming at me. But I found the mistake and I fixed it. So 3260E0 is, and this puts the result down there, and C9 marks the end of it. So if we take 1 plus 1 again and try this program, well, it puts 2 down here because all the other values is 0. But let's add these 3 numbers here. Boom, 3. 1, let's 1 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Oops. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Or 0, 8. Add these, and the I used that program. I have to use the new advanced version. So, and the result is 55. Nice. Okay, I think that's enough for this video. We've done a lot. I've showed you the basics of registers and memory and how the CPU does or how it does not interpret the data. And we added numbers, we've done a loop even. And I hope you liked this. And I will do more, maybe, I don't know what will be next, maybe some input and output. And of course, we won't stay on that low level for long, because typing in the machine code by hand and looking it up in a table, it's kind of boring and you can make mistakes. And what the next logical step to do is writing down the code in the readable form, like the abbreviations you saw in the instruction listing. It would be much better to write down these instead of the opcode, so you can actually see what's going on and read it, and have a program look up the actual opcodes and calculate address offsets and all that boring and tedious stuff.
And such a program is called an assembler. In fact, I've been using an assembler on the PC to write the code for the machine code monitor, because writing that in machine code would be it would take too long. But I want the system to have an assembler on its own, so you can write code in assembly language and assemble it to machine code without any other hardware. And I'm working on the file system right now, so because you have to store your code somewhere, so your assembler code, before, so it can be translated. When I have the file system, I need a text editor so we can enter the text, and then I can program the assembler. But I think for simple experiments, we don't need an assembler yet. We will use it later, when I have it and when we need it. If you like this, give it a thumbs up. If you haven't already, subscribe. And if you want me to do more, well, leave me a comment. The comments really encourage me to do this. And I've been really impressed by the number of people that subscribe to me. In fact, today someone commented, "Hey, make a new video on the 8-bit computer." And I thought, well, that's what I was going to do today anyway. But I'm not sure if I would really have done it today if it wasn't for that comment. Who knows? And I'm from Germany, by the way. This is Dresden where I'm now, in Eastern Germany. I moved from Berlin to here and built my new lab. It's in fact the place where I live. I don't live here in this room, but there's a bedroom and another small room and a kitchen. And this was supposed to be the living room, actually, but no, it's only living room. I don't need that. I need a lab. So I built this thing, and I'm really happy with this now. And I hope that I can spend entire weeks now, one week per month, on this. I think that's about it. It only took me an hour to record all this, but now I have to edit. Goodbye. As always, don't do that. No, I don't say it.